When you look to the energy system today, of course, it is from fossil fuels. But in the future, we don't want to have it from the fossil fuels with emitting the carbon dioxide emissions to the air. No, we want to produce without any carbon dioxide emissions to the air. And therefore, in the far future, we will have only solar, wind and other renewables to produce the energy that we need in the world. The techniques we have already at stake, but let me add one element to it. The potential for solar and wind is of course enormous. If you look to all the energy that we need in the world, about 150,000 terawatt hours, terawatt hours is billion kilowatt hours, then 10% of the Sahara Desert with solar PV is sufficient to produce all that energy, even less. So there is no energy problem and when you go to renewables, but you need to produce it, of course, in a way that it is cheap, reliable, that you can have it at any time that you want to use it. And at the places where you want to use it, you have to bring it to these places. Also with solar, you can produce directly hydrogen. And that is what you do if you have put a photon, the sunlight, into water and you need some catalyst, so etc. But then you can split the water molecule directly by the sunlight. That's the interesting new technology that you see is emerging. All the universities, technical universities in the world work on this concept. But it is not there, it is not cheap, it is not it is degrading a lot. But this is a new technology. But you are right, most of the energy that we will produce will be by solar and wind electricity. When you can use this electricity directly, you have to do. That's also a no-brainer. But you see that we have our solar and wind resources, the very good resources. Yeah, solar in the desert areas, wind offshore, in remote places like Patagonia or Kazakhstan, where you normally don't have the demand. And therefore you have to see how could we transport that cheap electricity from solar and wind to the demand, and how can we bring that at the right time to this demand. And that's the next question. Hey, now we can produce it for, say, 1-2 cents per kilowatt hour. Is it possible to bring it cheaply and reliable to the clients at the demand? And then you see it makes sense to convert the electricity to hydrogen. And how do you do that? It is an electrolysis technology. You have water. You put the electricity in the water and you split the water molecule H2O into hydrogen and oxygen. And then you transport the hydrogen, because that is an energy carrier, by pipeline. And if you transport hydrogen by pipeline instead of electricity by a cable, then the cost of transport are a factor of 10 smaller, lower than when you transport the electricity. And also when you look to a pipeline can transport much more energy than an electricity cable. To mention some figures, a pipeline can transport up to 20 gigawatts in capacity, but a cable today, the biggest cable that we now install is 2 gigawatts DC for offshore wind, for example. So that's the interesting point. If you convert, you can have much cheaper cost for transport, and you have to transport from the desert areas, for example, to Germany or to the Netherlands or to the north of Europe, you could say, distances of 2,000-3,000 kilometers away, and then of course the factor of 10 is not a factor of 10 only, but on these distances it's a large extra cost that you impose on the transport of electricity instead of hydrogen. And then the second thing is that you want to bring it at the right time to the people or to the industry or whatever. And that means that if you have, even in the desert during night, you don't produce electricity with solar. So it is intermittent. And therefore you see how could we store that energy in a way that we can indeed use it at the moment that that the demand is there. And that can be done like we do with natural gas today in salt caverns, which are very big holes in a very salt rock. And these holes are big because you can put the Eiffel Tower in such a salt cavern, or you can do that in some of the empty gas fields again. The interesting thing is, we can reuse even our natural gas pipelines. They are fit for transporting the hydrogen. And if you look to the transport system, it's not the pipeline, but it is the compressor. You compress it to get a large volume, energy volume in your pipeline. And these compressors are not fit, for natural gas, are not fit for hydrogen. So you have to replace or to retrofit these compressors. But pipeline systems are easily to adapt to the transport of hydrogen. And that means, for example, in Europe, where we have an extensive gas pipeline system, that we can bring the hydrogen by this converting this gas infrastructure into a hydrogen infrastructure to everybody, to every house, to every industry. And that's a very big thing, because it doesn't need extra infrastructure. The infrastructure is already there. And of course, when you produce, for example, fertilizers, and fertilizers use hydrogen to produce ammonia, which is the main component of fertilizers, then you can ship the ammonia, of course, around the world. Then you produce hydrogen, convert to ammonia, and ship the ammonia to use for as a fertilizer in or to make fertilizers in Europe, of course. But let me say, you can do it by ship, but that's the flexibility option. If you look to hydrogen, it's also the building block of all chemicals and synthetic fuels. From hydrogen you can make ammonia. Ammonia is the only component where you don't need carbon, but you can, for example, also make methanol, or you can make synthetic kerosene or synthetic diesel. And what do you do? Then you need hydrogen, but you need also a carbon source. And that carbon source could be from the waste products, and then you call it circular. For example, you gasify plastic and then you win back the carbon dioxide that is in the of the carbon that is in that plastic, and you use it to make methanol, for example, or to make synthetic kerosene. And in this way you can do that also sustainable, but you can also do it from the biogenic waste. From manure, where you produce biogas, and then you convert the biogas into hydrogen and CO2, and then you combine it in a different way to make, for example, synthetic kerosene. And today we make hydrogen from the fossil fuels. We make already a lot, because we need it in our refineries, and to make the fertilizers or to make methanol, you need the hydrogen. And that's now made from natural gas, mainly. And in some countries by coal even, but natural gas is the main resource to make hydrogen. But then, of course, the CO2 now is released to the air. If you look to the new technology developments, you see, for example, a technology that is called methane pyrolysis. And methane pyrolysis, that is superheating the methane, CH4, and then you split the CH4 molecule into solid carbon and hydrogen. So no CO2 emissions are there. You only have a solid carbon, which is not going into the air. You can bury it or whatever you want to do. But it is even something that you can use to revitalize your soil, your ground. And because it binds the minerals and the water in the ground, and then you keep it into the ground. So this is the new technology, or even this, like electrolysis, is not a new technology. It's there already for decades. Now we make some carbon black, as it is called, and the byproduct is hydrogen. That was also with electrolysis. Electrolysis was meant to make chlorine from salt, and the byproduct is hydrogen. Also, methane pyrolysis is the same thing, and we can do that on a large scale, also for our natural gas conversion to hydrogen, and then we don't produce any CO2 emissions. If we now allow still natural gas coming flowing into our system, yeah, then we are stuck with natural gas for decades. And even now today, we have new gas fields that we want to explore. For example, here in the Mediterranean Sea, they have found new gas in Egypt, Israel, Cyprus, Turkey, and they want to. They have given concessions to exploit that gas over there. Then it's there for 30, 40 years. They want to build a new pipeline, the EastMed pipeline, a natural gas pipeline. If that is flowing into the European system, yeah, then we are stuck with the CO2 emissions connecting to the gas. So what could we do to avoid that gas lock-in? And that is converting it by methane pyrolysis. Then you have no carbon CO2 emissions to the air at the resource, because there you can do that, so at sea. And then you put in the hydrogen in the pipeline, and then you can also immediately feed in the renewable or the green hydrogen from electrolysis in these countries where they have the good resources in these pipelines, and then you change your system much faster into a hydrogen system than that you keep it a natural gas system, and that is the advantage. Yeah, the future has started yesterday, so to say. And the technology is not the problem. If we scale up electrolysis technology, then it will become very cheap also, like solar cells. If you scale up the methane pyrolysis technology, it will become very cheap. That's like today, the gas steam methane reforming technology, for example. So that's not the problem. But the problem is that we have to be very bold in our policies to make this change. If the EU allows this, for example, this gas coming into the system, yeah, no way that we will have zero emissions by 2050 in the EU. But now we have to be bold also in the EU to say, oh no, we don't want to have natural gas flowing into the system, convert it at the resource, and give us the hydrogen. Then you can make the change.